Welcome back to Let's Play Pillars of Eternity Blind. I'm the RPG chick. We have a couple books to read. How exciting. But I like reading about the lore of this game. And then we have to go back into the Goose and Fox to find Kaenra. Now that we find Purnisc, who hit her and stuff, and seems like he misses her very much, but I don't know. He's a jerk. Who knows? Maybe he was being controlled by something, but... Anyway, two books we just found. House... We found this in the Thieves' Guild. Or the Thieves' Den. Which is right over there. It's unmarked, of course, being a Thieves' Den. House Doemenel. What can be said about House Doemenel that isn't whispered fearfully in a back room over the dim light of a dying fire in fear that the wrong set of ears will hear it? The Doemenel history is colorful and violent, exciting, and more than a little bloody. The Doemenels were a small Adiran family that dealt almost exclusively in textiles. They made a modest living, slowly gaining a reputation for having high-quality product. This reputation earned them connections, business, social, and sometimes marital, that solidified their position as the premier family of the region. If you wanted access to anyone, the Doemenels were the way to do it. Soon- whoa, I hate that. No. Hello. Hold on a second. Soon, every city had a business that was owned, at least in part, by the Doemenels. Their power and influence grew, until many said the family had more power than even the fair Koning of Adir. But with the power came the corruption. One cannot have that level of control and expect to keep it through strictly legal means. Soon, rumors were spreading of threats and extortion. Though it cannot be proven, the unofficial report is that the Doemenels were responsible for the death of Trindig Birnwiger, who left his entire shipping empire in the hands of his wife, Udel. Well, I'm not going to say that again. Doemenel... whatever. With their hold of the land periodically secured, the Doemenels no longer stuck to the shadows, brazenly eliminating opponents, manipulating deals, and threatening anyone who might cause them a problem. Because they now dominated the trade route, no one dared oppose them anymore for fear their business would be strangled. Like most empires, though, not even theirs could last forever. The end came during the War of Defiance. Unlike most of the land, the Doemenels threw in with Adir instead of Admeth Hadrat. After the defeat of the Empire and the destruction wrought on the land during the war, not even the Doemenels could rebuild what they had. And, having history shown them on the wrong side of the war, no one could touch the name. The domain that took years to build crumbled in mere months. Today the Doemenels have once again built a name for themselves, proving they are still capable and savvy business people. Rumors about the family still circulate, though. Word is members of the family are striving to lift the family from its current obscurity and elevate it to the level of power it once held. Okay. Wonder if I'll ever run into any of them. Dunryd Row. The origins and practices of Dunryd Row are difficult to nail down. When asked, everyone seems to know how Dunryd Row started and how long it's been in operation. Yet every person asked gives a different account of its creation and a different date. The only thing everyone can agree on is that it seems to have been around as long as anyone can remember. Without fail, everyone recalls hearing about the exploits of Dunryd Row when they were children. Aside from the organization being comprised of special investigators, most of whom seem to be ciphers, and the fact that they seem to have their hands in everything, yet never admit to it, anything reported about Dunryd Row walks the line between truth and outright hearsay. Information abounds, but no one can say which fragments are truth and which are fiction. I will provide all I have uncovered and leave it to the readers to decide for themselves, as all of it feels both plausible and unbelievable at turns. The group is supposedly named after the street where its headquarters are located, in a building called Hadrat House. It is said in some circles that this is just the name they want people to think they're known by. Their real headquarters, people whisper, is elsewhere. Why would they do this? It's simple. It's far easier for them to infiltrate, to hide, to carry on behind the scenes if everyone is concentrating on Dunryd Row. Divert attention where you want people to look, and you can act behind their backs with impunity. People who have had interactions with agents from Dunryd Row invariably describe them as unmemorable. No detail as to their appearance, behavior, or anything, beyond the fact that they were there, seems to stick with anyone. Are they truly nondescript, or do their ciphers use their powers to remain anonymous? As with so many questions regarding Dunryd Row, no one seems to know. While no specific details about the agents are ever reported, one fact that all people agree with is that they seem primarily to be Orlans and Glamfellen elves, though theories as to why this may be are many and conflicting. Their presumed headquarters is supposedly run by Lady Adis Webb. Though no one seems able to pinpoint the time of her arrival, the author was unable to locate a single person familiar with Dunryd Row who could remember a time when she wasn't around. Many things are hinted at behind closed doors about Lady Webb, but few are willing to elaborate, for it is rumored that although she has not left Hadrett House since anyone can remember, she is a cipher of tremendous power and that she can read the thoughts of the entire city at will. Theories abound regarding her age, her reasons for what would seem to be a lifetime of seclusion, and even of her secret control over all of Defiance Bay, if not Deerwood itself. But with all other matters regarding the organization, no one seems to be able to say anything for sure. Huh, a mysterious organization of ciphers. Interesting. Alright, let's go check out, let's go fulfill this quest, or further this quest. And there is one more place for us to investigate in this quarter before we move on.
No problem.
Not a problem. Hail, Kaenra. That guy is very bad at dancing. Kaenra looks up as you approach. What happened with Purnisc? Did you give him the ring? Was he impersonated? He was, okay. I wasn't sure if he was telling me the truth or not. Why is that lying? He was in prison upstairs. I guess that's just a lie of omission. Purnisc was being impersonated by a powerful wizard. However, the real Purnisc also deals Sfef. She blinks at you, stunned. I had no idea. Purnisc, he... She brings her fist down on the table, sloshing her drink. Damn it! How can I trust him after something like this? That he's lied to me for so long. She runs her hands through her hair and takes a deep breath. I should just be glad I found out about this before the wedding. I don't want to give her advice about this. I'm sorry it turned out like this. So am I, but thank you for telling me the truth. Oh, and take this. She unclasped something from her neck, picked it up from one of the merchants to help me stand firm in my decision. I'll be fine without it now. We gained an item, Unwavering Resolve. Who has this? Oh. Plus 2 intellect, plus 1 resolve. Huh. Young Talino Keel and his father were ambushed by Vithrak while on their way to Twin Elms. Before the child even registered the strange arachnids, his father thrust something into his hands and told him to run. Well, these are psionic spiders? As he turned to flee, the creatures blasted him with psionic energy. Talino's mind reeled, suddenly overcome by the insidious power. Suddenly, he was pulled back to his immediate surroundings. Half sprinting, half stumbling away from the Vithrak and his stricken father, Talino made it to the edge of town before he collapsed. The town guards were baffled at how the child had withstood the attack. Because of this. The item his father had given him was an old silver medallion. It was badly worn and missing its chain, and the words, "Do not yield to fear," were barely visible upon its surface. As soon as he came of age, Tolino joined the personal guard of a local thane. When he did, he strung it on a thin silver chain and commissioned a priest to enchant the medallion with additional protective wards. Tolino went missing years later while on an expedition in the White March. Hold on a second, guys. I got something. It's weird. I think I've been poisoned. Something scratched my ankle. Oh, I got a blister or something. It's weird, though. It's a long blister, like a scratch, but it's a blister. Okay. Who can use this thing? Aloth, perhaps? Of will plus 10. Edir's just wearing a regular cape. Let's give him this thing. Of intellect and resolve. Huh, we have another option with her? I'm not really in the mood for small talk, she says. Just thought you might need a hand. I'll get there. She takes a long drink from her glass, just trying to calm down, and trying to talk myself out of something foolish. We shouldn't even have this option. Alright. We shouldn't even have the option to talk to her again about that. We've fulfilled the quest. Okay, let's check out this one last place in Kaperlene. That we know of, anyway.
Sagani, does your fox bite?
Yes.
Can I pet him anyway?
It's your hand.
I'm gonna pet him.
Let's go pet him.
Hey.
Pat him.
Yeah.
No one wants to talk at this point? No, okay. I try to check that every now and then because it's so easy to miss. A call for interested patrons. We're not interested. Psych. The Admeth's Den Expedition Hall pledges competent, proven men and women towards the profitable venture of your choosing. Interested parties are asked to seek out when and within the Expedition Hall. Okay, we're headed there. Who's saying this, by the way? These guys? Forget the keep. Admeth's Den is the real heart of Defiance Bay. What's wrong with looting? No one's touched these artifacts in centuries. Are those artifacts? The Duke doesn't care about our illegal expeditions. The Knights do. There's more around here? No. Okay. Just being thorough here. So we can run along all here, but... no. Okay. Hmm.
The dozens may not like us foreigners much, but they certainly don't mind taking our coin.
No. In fact, most people around here won't mind taking our coin. I've been on a few expeditions. Good money if you return in one piece. Duke Eivor is a man of the people. He won't let this animancy nonsense go on. Looks like he's got horse legs. As Win in. Books. Book of the Hunt we have. Well, that one, Excerpts, is different. Oh, and the dozens.
And what does the flame reveal?
What?
Oh, it's getting increased. I want to check out those books. I'll read them after I talk to Weenan. Corin. Ooh, what's going on here? Who that? Who them? Bandon Lear. A well-groomed man steps through the hall with a confident swagger, a smug grin etched on his face. He is flanked by five other hard-looking individuals. Bine the Nimble. One of his companions eyes you for a moment before spitting chew at your feet. Thanks. Another pup come wandering in, I see. Just know that Bine's giant slayers run things around here and you'll be fine. Can I join? He laughs. Around here we get our pick of the best adventurers and we don't take charity cases. A voice bellows across the hall. Huenan yells, "Enough jabber, Bine. You gonna do the job or talk about it?" Bine's jaw tightens. Winan's right. That coin ain't gonna collect itself. He looks at his comrades and jerks his chin towards the door. See you around, pup. Yeah, see ya. That was interesting. I was trying to look at this Corin person. That's a history. You see three human boys walking through a city street, pushing each other and joking with one another. They stop, one of them pointing down the road, and look at each other. This Orlin, though younger and smaller, is the target of their attention. She has a handful of coins that she passes from hand to hand and is moving toward the marketplace. The boys move quickly, working their way around her through the crowd until they form a line in front of her, herding her into a shadowy corner away from the main thoroughfare. The boys taunt her, accuse her of stealing the coins, talking over her protests of innocence. They threaten her, telling her they will turn her over to the city watch for thievery if she doesn't give them the coins, because they can help at least three unfortunates with the money. One of the boys reaches for the coins, but she pulls her hand back. He cuffs the side of her head and grabs her hand, forcing it open, letting the coins drop into his palm. The boys laugh, thanking her for her service, then disappear into the crowd. The Orlin looks around, tears welling in her eyes. She spies a member of the watch and runs over, telling him that she was just robbed. The guard is unmoved, informing her that if he helps, she's just going to let it happen again next time. She protests, telling him that it's his job to help, but the guard is unmoved and unmoving. She stares at him for quite some time, fury burning behind her small eyes. Without saying another word, she turns and storms off, her face set with resolution. That was a rude sound. And Claru Zema? You see this Orlin cautiously making his way down a dark stone corridor. His eyes are wide and he is constantly looking over his shoulder, every noise making him jump. He appears dressed for adventuring, but his armor is ill-fitting and his pack refuses to stay on his back. Another sound reaches his ears from behind him and he spins around, peering into the darkness, trying to discern the source of the noise. He stands there for several seconds, holding his breath, staring. When nothing happens, he lets out a relieved sigh and turns to continue walking. His pack slips from his shoulder and cooking implements tumble out, sending a clattering din down the quiet hall. He freezes, listening in the tomb's silent aftermath of the accident. Booming footsteps reach his ears from behind him. He lets out a little squeal and runs away from the approaching creature, clattering through his spilled gear. The footsteps speed up and the Orlin squeals again, hurrying down the hall. There is a guttural growl close behind him and he turns to see an ogre emerge from the darkness behind him. The squeal becomes a yell and he puts his head down and breaks into a run. The ogre steps on the spilled gear and lets out a bellow of pain, breaking stride and looking down at its foot as it continues to hop forward. Panicked, the Orlin hits a tripwire pulled across the corridor without even noticing it there. It knocks his feet out from under him, and he tumbles to the floor, rolling a bit before ending up on his back. He lifts his head slightly and looks down the hall. The ogre has regained its stride and is running at him, hand out, intent on grabbing him. Both Orlin and ogre are unaware of the battle axe swinging a deadly arc through the air, accidentally tripped by the Orlin. The axe buries itself in the ogre's face, stopping it in its tracks, hand extended, blood making a trail down its face and dripping to the floor. The Orlin stares wide-eyed as the ogre goes limp, its weight slowly pulling it off the axe with a wet sucking sound. It comes loose and falls, eliciting a final squeal from the Orlin, who scoots backward to avoid getting squashed by the falling ogre's head. After a few moments processing what just happened, the Orlin quickly scrambles over the ogre's body and runs down the hall toward the exit. How many more books? How many more histories?
I'm on the trail.
Can I see what's in this? Hold on.
A simple test.
Sure, maybe we can buy lockpicks here.
That's settled.
$105 silver lucius. Not sure that was worth it. Keep your guard up, or I'll give you something to guard, damn you. Arrows are for practice in the expedition hall only. Practice stance is going to get you killed. Purchase weapons for personal use from Sonil, no exceptions, Osric. Have you even held a weapon before? Put some weight into that swing. The outer bands of this target are pocked with countless holes. The knights patrol to keep us out of the ruins, but who keeps them out? Or who keeps them out?
Hey.
The edge of these swords have been blunted for practice.
All right, then.
I didn't mean just you. Daggers mark the location of various Ingwithin ruins. Notes posted around the map. List bets on current expeditions.
Some fermented caribou milk would hit the spot right now.
Before I talk to this guy over here, let's talk to Wainan.
Don't stand on ceremony. State your business.
This rough-looking man glances at you briefly as he scans the mercenaries milling around the room. Tell me about the dozens. Wainan's expression becomes serious, the timbre of his voice deepening. Good men and women trying to walk in the footsteps of great men and women who came before us. We're a loose association of warriors and expeditionaries in the Deerwood. Not as fancy as the Crucible Knights, mind you, but at least we remember our roots. Edra says, at least they remember someone else's roots and pretend to be like them, he means. Your roots? The Crucible Knights take pride in having won the Deerwood's freedom 150 years ago, but we're the ones who've protected it. Everyone knows that the Saints' War ended when the Godhammer destroyed Widewind at Even Deer Bridge. Doer Bridge? A lot of folks don't know how Widewind wound up on that bridge. 7 men, 5 women, they walked out of Helgoth Citadel and faced down a god, held him there until the bomb went off. He thumps the table. That's the legacy we defend. Some call us mercenaries, but we don't need matching armor and silky cloaks to remember our roles. We're the same now as we were then. We stand up for the people. First line of defense, whatever it takes. We've got new enemies now. If it's not Widwin, it's his damn legacy. It's the damn soul butchers in Brackenbury making things worse on all of us. Probably causing the whole thing one way or another. Well, we haven't gone anywhere, and there's a lot more than 12 of us now. We defended Deerwood once. We'll do it again. Wainan casually nods your way. His eyes continue to float from mercenary to mercenary as he speaks. What else do you need? Sure, I'm looking for work.
Go see Osric. He's usually got something. You do well for him, maybe I can find you more.
He looks you up and down. Finally, he points to a man leading drills. That's Osric, obviously. Okay.
For the last time, Aedwig, keep your fucking blade up! If that dummy was armed, it'd have your head off!
This man watches the training adventurers with the disinterested contempt of someone whose skills are wasted in this setting. He barks at one of them and says that. Tell me about the expedition hall. It's treasure hunting, plain and simple. Sponsors put up money, hire adventurers to explore the wilds, looking for ruins, mostly. If they come back alive, they split the spoils. If not, it's because they handle their weapons like this lot in front of me, who might as well be digging their own graves right now. Got business with me? I'm looking for work.
You want an expedition? Talk to Wenon. I just handle these mercenary shit shovelers. Adventurers, I mean.
He told me to come see you. Although, he sizes you up, I do have something I need done. Something that requires... He glances sidelong at an adventurer flailing away helplessly at a dummy. Competence. What do you need done?
I was formerly one of the Knights of the Crucible. When I left, they kept my arms and armor. The arms they can have, but the armor belonged to my family. I'd like it back.
Why don't you just go ask for it back?
No. Oh, they'd like that, I'm sure. But I won't be going. Sooner be torn apart by dogs than give them the satisfaction.
Doesn't sound like leaving the Crucible Knights was your choice.
You don't choose to leave knighthood. The Crucible Knights, they may not be a real knighthood, but the oaths you swear are just as true. Still, turns out that even unofficial knighthoods have politics. You cross the wrong man, suddenly all kinds of accusations are thrown your way, and nobody believes you.
Eder says nothing more destructive than a crowd with the wrong idea. What's this armor?
It's a breastplate. Not much to look at, and it's seen far too much use, but it's been in my family since the liberation.
I'll see what I can do.
Then it's Penhelm you're looking for. A low snake of a man. If he was to die choking on his own black tongue, it'd be too kind of fate. He kept it when he had me kicked out. I got word from a reliable source that Penhelm visited a forger in Andra's gift, right after being soul-scanned by a cipher in Dunryd Row. Should you have it in your heart to find a way to ruin his life while you're there? Well, drink's on me.
Being soul-scanned or having his soul lineage read?
It's a requirement to join the Knights. They have to ensure a novitiate doesn't have a subversive lineage. If Penhelm's superiors found out his affidavit was a fake, his career would be over. Every novitiate gets an affidavit from Dunryd Row, and those are stored at Crucible Keep. If you find Penhelm's, one of those ciphers could tell you if it's real.
Sagani scratches the back of her neck. If generations of Masuk's traditions are any indication, this Penhelm probably doesn't remember it. Still, a past like that has to count for something. Cool. Do we have time to read these books? Excerpts from the Sermon of Struggle? Choice is a luxury we earn through peace. Struggle is our fundamental nature. Even when our war banners sit idle, mankind foments strife. Friends argue with fists, lovers kindle jealousies, merchants compete with lies. Wherever mankind goes, struggle follows. Magrin is goddess of fire and war, not bloodshed and conquest, though many in Red Saras would tell it differently. How bitter they must be that Magrin's priests were able to destroy a god made manifest. How bitter indeed. We who worship Magrin are not addled barbarians or cloistered mystics. We are soldiers, armorers, watchmen, and bodyguards, artisans of conflict and protectors of our families and flags. We do not salivate for battle. We view war as unwelcome. But struggle is our fundamental nature. We do not pray for strife. We pay for the wisdom to resolve it quickly. We do not wish for war, but when it inevitably must be fought, we find divine ecstasy in discipline, efficiency, and excellence. Magrin, guide us to the battle that is just and fair. Let us be your fire that burns away the profane, leaving only the righteous. If struggle is our fundamental nature, I can't even say that for some strange reason tonight, let victory be our inevitable state of grace. And the dozens. I'm really interested in finding out about the dozens, actually. Okay, we didn't read this, right? Scarcely a decade ago, on the Evan Dewar Bridge, 7 men and 5 women fought valiantly to protect their homeland. They volunteered for the mission knowing it was up to them, and them alone, to prevent St. Widwin from crossing the bridge. They succeeded, even though they lost all but 4 of their number in the battle. And Widwin was on the bridge when the godhammer detonated. The final 4 were lost in the blast as well, their sacrifice a testament to their dedication. The Dozens, a group ostensibly formed for the protection of the Deerwood, was founded in the honor of those men and women. Indeed, those 12 men and women are posthumously regarded by the Dozens as their true founders. Initially, the group dedicated itself to protecting Deerwood from invasion, patrolling the borders tirelessly in search of Red Saren forces regrouping for another attack. When that attack never materialized, many of the Dozens thought the next threat might come from Eothasian loyalists living in Deerwood and began to turn their attention within. All new members of the Dozens are required to swear an oath to remember the sacrifice of their founders and remain vigilant against Red Saras and any followers of Aethas. To this end, worshippers of Aethas are routinely harassed by the Dozens. The mindset of this group may be hard for some to understand, as any fanatical devotion can sometimes overshadow the ideals. But the original Dozen knowingly sacrificed their lives for Deerwood. From the Dozen's perspective, how can any new members of the Dozens be any less committed to their country's welfare? What better way could there be to honor their founders? The Dozens are not a large group, but what they lack in size they make up in fervent devotion to their cause and a gift for gaining the ear of commoners. This makes them a force to be reckoned with, and there is no more influential group in shaping the discourse surrounding Widwin's legacy. A small but very vocal minority of extremists in the group are calling for a new war with Red Saras. Talk of purging the Deerwood of all followers of Eothas is also being touted. More recently, they have begun to see in the practice of animancy a possible cause to the legacy, and they have taken to the streets of Defiance Bay and the dirt roads of many distant settlements to make their case to the general public. Some point to this as one source of a recent surge in vigilantism and violence in the country. Most interesting. Was there more in there? Hold on a second. It looked like there wasn't, like... There is! Okay. Okay, we're gonna finish exploring this next episode, and then we're gonna move on. Believe it or not, we're gonna be done at least for now, quests notwithstanding and such, we're going to be done with the Copper Lane District, and we'll be moving on to some other district. I haven't decided which one yet. Thanks for watching. See you in the next one, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.